This episode of First Cup is brought to you by Wishing Stars Native Creations, Fine Art Today, and Marshall Woodworking. Check out these companies and many more by going to the Friends page at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House or tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. Hi friends, Joe Hafner here. I'll have the latest episode of First Cup for you coming up in just a few seconds. I want to take this time, though, to remind you of a few things. If you have something on your mind in regards to this show, things that you like or don't like, or as well as Song of the Day request, you can submit those emails to gunthershouseoffriends@gmail.com. Again, that's gunthershouseoffriends@gmail.com. Also, you can send me your messages via Skype at G800-486-8437. That's G800-486-8437. Follow me on Twitter at jhafner99. That's the letter J, H-A-F-F-N-E-R, the number 99, jhafner99. Also, friend me on Facebook by looking for the hot link at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House. That's good on your PC, Mac, Linux, or tablet computer, or on your smartphone, whether it's an Android, iOS, or Windows phone, as well as on your tablet computer by going to tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. Also, you can listen to previous episodes of First Cup, as well as other shows that I produce, such as Joe's Retro Radio, by going to the Stitcher app, which is available via hot link on the opening page of my website, as well as at Stitcher.com. You can also find me on Spreaker.com, that's speaker with an R after the P, Spreaker.com be heard, as well as on Miro at GetMiro.com, and on iTunes. Look up Gunther's House of Friends on those aforementioned sites, as well as at the Windows Media Store. Again, Gunther's House of Friends on the Windows Store. And now, without further delay, here I am with today's broadcast.
I got boogers! Cold, frozen boogers!
Well, have you heard about this in the news? Beginning in 2014, the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. will start charging a $10 fee to tourists. You know, anybody who has a problem with the cover charge can talk to the bouncer, Pope Francis. Good morning, my friends. Today is Monday, December 9th, 2013, and you know what that means. It's time for your First Cup.
To do to save his life, call his wife in. Nothing to say, but what a day. How's your boy been? Nothing to do, it's up to you. I've got nothing to say, but it's okay.
Good morning, good morning, good morning.
Going to work, don't wanna go. Feeling low down. Heading for home, you start to roam. Everybody knows there's nothing doing. Everything is closed, it's like a ruin. Everyone you see is half asleep. And you're on your own, you're in the street. After a while, you start to smile. Now you feel cool. Then you decide to take a walk by the old school. Nothing has changed, it's still the same. I've got nothing to say, but it's okay. Hope she goes. I've got nothing to say, but it's okay.
Good morning, good morning.
And a good morning, my friends. Welcome to another edition of First Cup, 9th day of December 2013, on a cold winter morning. Might as well be winter out there, right? I think it's only about 15 degrees at best out here in Kirksville. I have details on the weather forecast for the entire country, known as the United States of America, coming up in just a few minutes, as well as the Kirksville regional weather forecast, along with today's news headlines, plus what else do I have for you? Popular tweets of the day, the song of the day, a whole lot more, all jam-packed into this neat little podcast, a little show I like to call First Cup. But first things first, have some business to take care of here. I have to go get my refreshing beverage and take care of a few things, so bear with me as I talk to you. And, what's on the radio? Oh, nothing on the radio there. Let's see if this coffee machine's got anything in it. Oh, there comes the cup. There comes the cup. I smell that fresh brew now. Oh, yeah, that's really good. Okay, let's see what's on the TV. Nope, nothing there. Nothing but the static channel. Okay, turn that off. Okay, oh, that's off. Let's see what's in the microwave. All right, set this for 3 seconds. Okay, there we go. Ooh, microwave sounds a little heavy. There we go. All right, I need to take this out. Ah, pour some coffee. All right, there we go. A cheap little sound effect mix that I put together yesterday. I don't know what I'm going to do with it yet, but I'll figure something out. Well, welcome to the program. I apologize for my tardiness. I know, nothing like being 3 hours late to my own party, right? But that's the nice thing about being my own boss around here, in that I can get away with stuff like that, well, to a certain extent. But hopefully my sponsors will understand. And the snooze button, it's one of the most evil things ever invented in the world. Of course, I didn't have to use it, but I chose to this morning. I thought, well, I'll just sleep for a few more minutes. That was at about 6:50 when I woke up. And then when I woke up again, after I hit the snooze button, it was 9:06. I'm thinking, whoa, okay. Well, I overshot that one quite a bit. So, had a few errands I had to run before the show and then upload my material to the server. So while that was uploading, ran my errands, and I've come back, and now, well, here I am. And hope that you will stick around for the program as well. Part of the reason why I overslept, I stayed up way too late last night. After I got done with Joe's Retro Radio, which incidentally episode number 5 is coming up in 13 days on the... what day will that be? That's 2 weeks from yesterday. I'll do a little quick math. Be on the 22nd. 6 o'clock that night on December 22nd, I'll have four old radio programs combined into that two-hour segment. Excuse me, a two-hour segment honoring Christmas past from the golden days of radio. Okay? So working on that. But anyway, after I got done with last night's Joe's Retro Radio, I thought, well, I haven't played with Netflix for quite a while. It doesn't make sense to go paying $7.99 a month for something that I hardly ever use. Now, my mom and her boyfriend use it more than I do. I thought, well, I'm going to check out what's on there. And I was going through some of the programs, and I was kind of in the mood for some sci-fi, kind of escapist type stuff. And I found the 4400. Now, those of you that don't remember, it was a show that was on USA Network about 10 years ago. It ran about 4 seasons. And I watched the majority of the first season, and I never saw anything after that due to work schedules and so forth. So I started watching that, and I thought, the show's held up fairly well. The cell phone technology is kind of laughable now. I never thought the cell phone technology would be that dated, but smartphones hadn't been invented yet or were still in development at that point. So I'm watching 4400. Then after that, I thought, well, what else is on here? And I got to... I watched the pilot episode of Orange is the New Black a couple of months ago. I thought, well, I'll watch that. And I watched about 2 or 3 episodes of that, and I'm thinking, wow, these women are good, and the storylines in there and so forth. I really feel sorry for Piper, even though she deserved to get caught for what she did. But it just, the show is like, whew. Yeah, this would never fly on network television. Could get it on cable television, possibly, but I commend Netflix for producing it and hope they produce more shows along that line. Okay. So, I didn't get to bed till probably about, well, after 2 o'clock this morning is when I finally dozed off. And I knew I was going to pay for it because I have a hard time getting consistent sleep. And I'm constantly disrupting my sleeping patterns, even though I took a couple of naps yesterday. But in between watching Netflix, and then in between that and running Joe's Retro Radio, which you don't know this, but I was falling asleep during my own show last night after I got done with my voiceovers. It's lucky that I woke up when I did, because there were a couple of times I had about maybe 2 minutes left in the show that was running before the next one started, and I had to hit start. Well, after I got done, immediately after I got done watching, or rather running Joe's Retro Radio, before I switched to Netflix, I pulled up some old Johnny Carson bits, including watching an old episode of The Tonight Show in its entirety with original network commercials from 1979. And boy, that brings back a lot of memories. Some of my earliest memories. And anyway, I'm kind of babbling here. I apologize. You'd think I'd be a little more organized today, but I'm not. It's Monday. And, well, who's organized on a Monday, right? Let's see. Let's get to what's on my mind for today. First of all, running around on Netflix or on Facebook this morning, and I saw this posting about an hour ago from the Today Show. And Carrie Underwood, who played Maria on NBC's live production of The Sound of Music. Speaking of The Sound of Music, I'm going to turn down this music just a little bit because it is a little bit distracting. It feels like I'm shouting, and I don't want to shout in your ear or my ears. Well, anyway, The Sound of Music is responding to, in a gentle manner to detractors of her portrayal of Maria, the iconic role made famous by Julie Andrews in 1965. Well, rather than blasting those who didn't fully enjoy her performance as the governess to the Von Trapp family children, the singer revealed that she prayed for them. And while many Christians out there are going, oh, that's a nice thing, that's a beautiful thing, and I'm thinking it's a bit condescending, and it's a sign of your insecurity. Because no matter who's going to play that part, they're always going to be compared to Julie Andrews. It doesn't matter whether it's an amateur production or it's a professional production like this one. There's always going to be that comparison. Now, I admit I have my hang-ups with prayer. I think it's largely just shouting into the wind. It has no real benefit, even though there have been studies that said that there are some medicinal benefits, but I think there are some other factors in there that surveyors are not taking into account. But I'm not going to stop you from praying. I can't do that. It's wrong of me, and it's arrogant of me to think that. But I thought it was a bit condescending, and to me it shows her insecurity. And I have not seen the performance. Some have said it was okay. Some have said it was really good. I did read that NBC plans to rerun this production at some point before Christmas, and I hope to see it then. But I didn't get to see it because I was at work that night, and I didn't record it, and I haven't bothered to look for it. And since NBC plans to run it, I doubt that they are going to video stream it for a while, if at all. But anyway, I just thought that was kind of funny there. What else is on my mind today? I'm probably going to take some heat for this, but occasionally on this show, on previous podcasts, previous morning shows, and weekly shows that I've produced, I focused a lot on Islamophobia, especially in this country. And something I've seen on Facebook in the last few days, and I've seen this picture before, but it's popped up again a lot in the last few weeks, and that there are a bunch of Muslims who are praying on Madison Square Garden out in the street. And various postings have blamed political correctness on allowing Muslims to pray at Madison Square Garden, but you and I can't pray publicly in a school or on other such public ground, which is nonsense. Again, and I know Muslims and Christians pray differently, but this is more directed towards Christians and even Jews. Why do you have to make a public spectacle about prayer? Why do you have to show off to me? You know, if you pray privately, that's fine. But this notion, though, our rights are being infringed upon. Well, this picture, though, is accurate. If you look at the grade quality and look at the vehicles in the background and even the clothing, you will note that that picture was taken probably circa 1987, I'm guessing, the picture that I'm thinking of. In other words, we can't blame this on modern political correctness. This has been going on for at least 30 years, 25 to 30 years in Madison Square Garden. And I get tired of Christians playing the victim card. I mean, if your belief system is that strong, you're going to do it regardless, okay? And I appreciate the fact that Christians comply with the law and the request. But it goes back kind of to what's going on in my high school alma mater, in that some people are feeling persecuted because of their beliefs, or rather aren't. Or those that don't believe are being persecuted by various Christian groups. Okay? There's a reason why there's a separation of church and state. Now, this on Madison Square Garden, I think they could find a better location. But don't go playing this victim card, okay? Saying that this is just a recent occurrence. This has been going on for decades, is what I'm getting at, okay? Please do a little more research before you post something on the internet. And I know I've been guilty of it too, that I've had knee-jerk reactions to things I've seen, things that get under my skin. And I try to do my best to do my homework before I respond, or at least know what I'm talking about. Because there's nothing worse than looking like a fool, and then you don't even admit that you're wrong, okay? Kind of like my intro to Joe's Retro Radio last night, forgetting the name. And I kept wanting to say Sergeant Squirt, and I knew that wasn't right, but I knew there was a Q in there. But anyway, that's a whole nother matter. Let's see what else is on my mind today. Interesting story that I found on Deseret News in regards to homeschooling. And anyway, Eric Peschel and his family have different reasons for homeschooling. But it seems now that there's a culture, homeschooling culture, shifting away from religious ties. In other words, that there are other reasons other than religion that are forcing some parents to think, well, maybe public education isn't the best thing for my kids here, or they're not getting what I think they should be getting out of school. Well, one of Peschel's sons was taken out of public school for religious reasons and bullying. Another is taught at home because for the public education system wasn't working for Peschel. His daughter was homeschooled too, but bonding issues caused the Peschels to put their daughter back into public school. Just seeing the difference between what is being taught in public school versus our school, it's not even close. Peschel said they're not even close in the vocabulary they're teaching or the math they're teaching. All right. And give me a moment for my computer to wake up here. You know, it's off the charts different. Though homeschooling has been a historically popular choice for religious conservatives, it's become more common among secular students. A National Center for Education Statistics study showed homeschoolers no longer list religion as their top reason for opting out of public or private schools. More than 91% see the environment as a reason to homeschool, while 64%, which is roughly just under 700,000 students, see religion as an important reason to homeschool. In 1999, about 327,000 students were homeschooled for religious reasons. Okay? And homeschooling has been on the rise too. More than a decade ago, in 1999, about 850,000 students were homeschooled, which was nearly half of the 1,770,000 homeschool students reported for the 2011-2012 school year. That's according to the NCES. Between bullying worries and lack of belief in the public education system, many parents choose homeschooling to avoid these problems. I've seen remarkable quality educations given to homeschool kids in remarkable ways. That's according to John Edelson, founder and president of Time for Learning, a homeschool curriculum organization. While I see that in public schools, too, parents are a lot more resourceful to give kids quality educations. But as homeschooling becomes more popular, it also faces added scrutiny. For example, in Nebraska, the Department of Education is looking to add new stipulations to track attendance for homeschoolers, which requires parents to fill out more paperwork. Other parents worry about the influence Common Core standards is already having on their ability to shape curriculum to the needs of their children. For many, taking back control of their child's education is a fight that only continues. Edelson of Time for Learning said there are three types of homeschoolers: religious people, free thinkers, and accidental homeschoolers who are pragmatically doing what's best for their kids. Because of this, academies that cater to homeschoolers or companies like Time for Learning have to adapt. Edelson offers students a non-religious curriculum that is part online and part offline. It begins with an opening discussion, then 30 minutes of computer work, and 30 minutes of desk work throughout the day. It's a way of tapping into a new market of virtual homeschoolers who are on the rise too. Instead of using the traditional method of hiring a homeschool teacher, some parents want to enroll their children in an online education system, which they can also do from home. Meanwhile, Jessica Parnell, principal of Bridgeway Homeschool Academy, which offers curriculum for homeschooling parents, is also marketing itself in new ways by including mainstream and secular curriculums as a way to bring in families who wish to avoid religious teachings. Global Village School, a homeschooling organization that offers online and text-based curriculum, decided to shift its marketing focus in recent months towards secular students due to demand. Okay, that's according to Gretchen Buck, the school's manager. She said part of this increased interest in homeschooling is from parents who think their children aren't getting enough attention in public schools. Now, another reason for the rise in new homeschoolers is because parents don't see the traditional classroom setting as helpful for their children. Parents then are taking it upon themselves to start teaching, as they believe they can teach their children better than the public school teachers can. So in many instances, I think this is a good thing. But it's interesting to see the shift in focus. Now, part of the problem I see with public education is, while that it brings about a unified standard, you know, in other words, offers a relatively neutral platform for people to think, or at least have a common core, you know, in other words, bring us to a common language, common ancestry. It also diminishes free thinking. You know, you don't hear about the radical free thinkers like you did in the 18th and 19th centuries, like you do now. I'm not saying there aren't any out there, but with this more of this collective mentality, I think ultimately it diminishes us. So I think homeschooling may not be a bad idea, or I think it should be included along with your public education or your private education. So just a couple of interesting scenarios there to consider on this Monday. Let's see what else I have for you. Not a whole lot to talk about today. Kind of take it easy. So we're going to switch things over and find out some things you need to know as we roll on through this Monday together. Of course, you're probably more informed by now than I am, because I got up late, and I should know better than to tap that old snooze button. But, you know, you do what you do. You do what you do. All right, let's take a look at some things you need to know for your Monday. All right, and give my computer a few seconds here to load the information. This tablet computer, for some reason, is really sluggish in the last few days. I don't know if it's because my internet is crapping out, or I need to purge it. I just reformatted this thing on Thanksgiving, so it shouldn't be that clogged. But now it's just sitting here going, You're going to listen to the music and the fire and just enjoy the warmth while I sit here and spin and spin and spin and spin. And you drink your coffee and kill time. And that's exactly what's happening right now. Okay. Come on now. Let me try this one more time. Reload. There we go. Wasn't that easy. Next, please. Uh-oh. Whoops. I enlarged it too much. That's what she said! Okay. Here's some things you need to know for this Monday. First of all, winter storm. Texas got it over the weekend, and the East Coast gets it today. National Weather Service says the worst will be from central Virginia to southeast New York. Some areas might see a quarter of an inch of ice before temperatures rise late this morning and the system moves on. As far as any fallout, sure. Just look at all the stranded travelers who are now living at airports. The nasty wintry weather canceled thousands of flights, a good number of them at Dallas-Fort Worth International Airport. As a matter of fact, according to Tom D, tweeted that we got about 6 inches of snow in Willow Grove on Sunday, followed by an overnight ice storm. Meanwhile, remembering Nelson Mandela, dozens of world leaders are on their way to Johannesburg to mourn the anti-apartheid leader and former South African president. President Barack Obama and First Lady Michelle Obama will be joined by former Presidents Bush, Clinton, and Carter. 91 heads of state and counting are expected to be the largest gathering of leaders in Africa's history. That is impressive. It'll be held at a 90,000-seat soccer stadium, but even that may not be enough to accommodate the public. Let's hope our leaders are watching these Mandela documentaries. They can learn much about nation building. That was from CNN, the little note from CNN. Waitress hoax, tipping point. Remember Dana Morales, who got lots of online love and some cash, serious cash donations after she said a family stiffed her on her tip because she was gay? That's been floating around on the internet in the last few days. I know I haven't talked about it on this show, but I have seen it. There's a problem. That's not exactly what happened. And now the restaurant and Morales have gone their separate ways. It's a joint decision. At least that's what the restaurant said. We haven't heard from her yet. A TV station did reveal that the family had indeed left her a tip, almost 20%. You know, there's enough hate in the world. It's a shame someone would fabricate a story like this. That's according to a tweet from Time Magazine, and I agree. Number four on the list today in thrill killing, just because I did talk about this, I think on Friday or Saturday's program. I'm not sure which day. Well, anyway, cops say newlyweds Elite and Miranda Barber were just looking for someone to kill together. They say the couple tried it before, but the plan didn't pan out. Troy LaFara was the unlucky one. He answered a Craigslist ad that Miranda allegedly placed, one looking for men who want companionship. And police say he met his death in her red Honda CRV, stabbed repeatedly by Miranda Barber, while her husband strangled him with a cord. After that, the couple allegedly dumped the body, cleaned up the SUV, and headed to a strip club. After all, it was Elite's 22nd birthday. I don't get that. I don't get that at all. And normally I would not say this, but I say just skip the trial. They've already admitted to this. Just execute them now. There's no reason to, other than to ask, why did they do this? But they're clearly not right in the head. You know, but why do we waste taxpayer dollars on keeping scum like this in prison? I don't get that. Meanwhile, in a related case off a cliff, another case involving a newlywed couple heads to trial today. Jordan Lynn Graham faces first and second degree murder charges in the death of her 25-year-old husband, Cody Johnson. Her prosecutors have accused her of murdering her husband by shoving him off a cliff at Glacier National Park in Montana. Her federal public defender says Johnson's death was an accident. Yeah, I'm sure it was. An accident that she got caught. And finally, former San Diego Mayor Bob Filner. Remember him? goes back to the early days of First Cup. As a matter of fact, I think my very first joke on my very first show was about him. Well, anyway, he's paying the price. It's sentencing day for San Diego Mayor Bob Filner. Under a plea deal, he'll get his punishment for kissing or grabbing three women at campaign events or City Hall. The 71-year-old pleaded guilty 2 months ago. There's no prison time, but Filner will get 3 months of home confinement, 3 years of probation, and mandatory mental health treatment. Fines, court fees, and restitution will also be tacked on. This year, 19 women accused him of offensive behavior during his tenure as mayor and 20 years as a congressman. And still, he just gets a proverbial slap on the wrist, but he'll screw up. He'll screw up, and he'll violate the probation, I'm sure of that. And here's some other biggies for the day. Things that are brewing on the internet. Have everybody on the internet buzzing. Silent Night, Crazy Night. The students at Taylor University in Upland, Indiana have a fun tradition. It's called Silent Night. At the annual basketball game on the Friday before final exams, the students fill the gym but stay quiet, dead quiet, not a peep, until the 10th point is scored. What happens next, you ask? Well, all you need to know is what breaks loose. And uh-oh, SpaghettiOs! What's more patriotic than pasta and Pearl Harbor? Never mind. The SpaghettiOs PR folks got into some hot water over the weekend using a certain circular noodle to honor the memory of those who died in the 1941 attack. Perhaps folks thought they weren't taking it seriously enough. You know, they apologized for their recent tweet in remembrance of Pearl Harbor Day. We meant to pay respect, not to offend. But that does look perverted. Anyway, the tweet says, take a moment to remember Pearl Harbor with us. And it has a picture of a SpaghettiO and red tennis shoes, red and white tennis shoes, holding an American flag in hand. Yeah, that's tacky. Cat bullies. Do cats have magical powers over dogs? Do they employ some sort of Jedi mind trick? All we know is that dogs, no matter their size, seem to cower in their presence. Yeah. I've known some dogs, though, that have brought about the hurt on a few cats in time, but I won't go into that. Well, those are some things you need to know for this Monday. All right. Well, coming up next on this edition of First Cup, what do I have for you? I'll have news headlines in a few minutes. Look at that nationwide weather forecast. And coming up next, though, will be things that are trending, things that you need to know. That's coming up on this edition of First Cup, so please stick around. More of the program is on the way.
I'd like to drop out of high school and get a meaningless job that makes me feel bad about myself.
I'd like to fall victim to the old boys network.
I don't want anybody to notice me.
I just want to fly under the radar.
I want to splatter against the glass ceiling.
I don't have an opinion.
I want to be a straight C student.
I'm going to be a biomedical engineer. I mean, I want to succumb to peer pressure all of my life.
I'm going to be a best-selling author and win the National Book Award.
I'm going to be a marine biologist.
Wait, I take mine back. I'm going to be a biomedical engineer.
I think I'll be the president.
I'm going to be Secretary of State.
World-class chef, right here.
Race car driver.
Artist. Paleontologist.
Film director.
Surgeon.
Teacher.
Scientist.
Olympian.
I'm going to be the boss.
You are about to enter another dimension, a dimension not only of work and earnings, but of pension and leisure, a journey into a wondrous land of imagination. You unlock this door with Social Security's retirement estimator and online benefit application. Next stop, the retirement zone. Picture a man sitting at his home computer. He isn't sure whether he should apply now or work a little longer and begin receiving benefits at age 70. He's about to find out with a visit to the retirement estimator. The estimator uses his past earnings and allows him to key in variable future earnings and retirement dates to complete the picture of a retirement he'd like to live. Enter the retirement zone yourself. Visit www.socialsecurity.gov. That's www.socialsecurity.gov. We'll see you in the retirement zone.
This episode of First Cup is brought to you by Wishing Stars Native Creations, Fine Art Today, and Marshall Woodworking. Check out these companies and many more by going to the Friends page at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House or tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile.
This is Jackson Brown wishing you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
The fame to Peter Gunn. Love Henry Mancini's work. Man was a genius. Welcome back to First Cup. Episode number, what is this episode number? 79? Yeah, episode number 79. We're back in the cozy confines of Studio 17. For the next couple of days, at least for today and tomorrow. Not sure where we'll be Wednesday, but probably here. Anyway, time to find out things you need to know, things that are trending on this Monday. So bear with me as I find the appropriate intro, and we'll be set to go. Okay, well, we've already played that, so I'll take it out of the playlist, put this in the deck, and hit the play button. And here's some things you need to know. First of all, if you're pouring coffee, make sure that you have something to wipe up the excess with.